Good morning, everyone. Richard here at Calvin Wazoo, where at least I'm running a race. I know I'm going to win. And this was starting off to be, you know, a recent finds video, but it's turned into weekend spins number three because, you know, I picked up a lot of records on Record Store Day plus some other records that I had picked up. And so, yeah, I've been going through them and doing them in smaller groups. And I was getting ready to make another one, you know, and I was starting off with this record here, okay? Actually, I didn't start off with this one. I listened to a couple others. But when I got to this one, this Joe Strummer and the Mescaleros, Rock Art and the X-Ray Style, this Record Store Day release on... some very nice pink vinyl. When I got to playing this one, I was really enthralled, and I was also wondering, you know, gosh, I, you know, been a huge Clash fan, and I knew about Joe Strummer's post-Clash career, as I also knew about, you know, Mick Jones and what he was doing after the Clash with, like, you know, Big Audio Dynamite. But I was, you know, more familiar with Big Audio Dynamite. I had listened to them. Hadn't listened to any Joe Strummer and the Mescaleros. So this was such a treat. And while listening to this and really enjoying, this is a great album. It sounds really, really good. So if you can find some copies of this Record Store Day release, I strongly recommend it. But as I was listening to it, I'm thinking, wow, Joe Strummer is an incredible storyteller. His songs are more, you know, again, it's that type of song where there is a story being relayed. It's not your typical structure for a pop song. And then I started thinking, wow, I wonder if Joe Strummer has ever met Bob Dylan, or does he feel that Bob Dylan has influenced his music? So I went and did a quick search to find some information, and yeah, they did meet. And in fact, they mutually admired each other's work. I mean, a lot of things, you know, going on. There was Dylan gave Strummer a tape of a song that Bob wanted Joe to record at one time, which I guess never did get turned into, you know, a record. But Dylan is partially covered London Calling in a Brixton Academy show in 2005. The Clash covered Dylan's song, The Man and Me. Dylan took his entire family to see The Clash play in St. Paul, Minnesota, which this was in 1979, and that turned Jacob Dylan into a, you know, a lifelong fan of The Clash. So there, you know, a lot of mutual admiration and covering of each other's material. In Bob Dylan's radio show, he would, you know, played The Clash as a, you know, response, kind of a thank you when Strummer played Dylan's Corrina Corrina on his radio show. You know, this was back in 2000, so I was like, yeah, okay, I hear this in the way Strummer is, you know, writing and expressing his songs. I mean, it's not, again, I'm not saying, you know, that, oh, this is like reductive, or this is Joe Strummer is like, no, he's a songwriter. Extraordinaire, just like Bob Dylan. And the stories he tells are representative of Joe Strummer's own, you know, life and experiences. just as, you know, Dylan's is a reflection of his own life and experiences and the perspective that he develops as a person. So I was like, wow, this is really cool. So that set me off on a musical journey. But before I go further into that musical journey, I do have one needle drop for you, and that is from this album, and it is the song Techno D-Day. DJ playing Beyond Mountain Beats. That was the song that really started gelling in my head, going, gee, I wonder if Strummer and Dylan like knew each other or met or whatever. Once I had recognized that connection between Joe Strummer and Bob Dylan, well, I had to listen to some Bob Dylan. And the one that I pulled out is this one here, Love and Theft, which is a 2001 album. Mine is the 2017 reissue. And yeah, wonderful, wonderful album. Great songs on here. Again, you know, the opener, Tweedledee and Tweedledum. But Dylan's song, Mississippi, which he gave to Sheryl Crow. So many really good songs on here. Probably with the Joe Strummer connection, I probably should have listened to something earlier, maybe like Blood on the Tracks or Desire even, but you know, this was a very good choice once I understood that connection. And then as the album is nearing its conclusion, I'm going, well, what is this making me want to listen to next? These, you know, all these, sometimes these musical journeys happen. And so this came to mind, and that is Spoon in the album Transference. Now, this is not considered Spoon's best work, and in fact, it's quite different, both in the production and recording techniques that were used, and to some degree also with the songwriting style. It's but this was my first Spoon album. And it's, while there are other Spoon albums I you know, would rate higher than this one, this is really kind of my go-to and my favorite one. When I bought it without it knowing anything about Spoon, in part, you know, because of the cute boy on the cover, but also the posture here, okay, that he's adopting. I mean, y'all must have at times been sitting in a chair where you just, you know, you kind of are like this and you're just kind of watching what's going on. And, you know, that headspace that's being portrayed with this photo is kind of like, you know, yeah, it's like it could be boredom. It could be or just like, you know, just not quite a condescending attitude, but, you know, kind of a, yeah, sure, whatever, kind of a, you know, in a situation that you're in that you can't really get out of without maybe being kind of rude. But anyway, Yeah, that was the right album to go to. I love the album Transference. I love the different songs on there. The Mystery Zone is probably my favorite one on the entire record, but there's a lot of really good ones, you know, on there. The Closer to Side One, Written in Reverse. You know, actually, Side One is really, really good. But yeah, so that's where I went next, was with Spoon and Transference. Well, from there, I returned to something, you know, it's one of my newer acquisitions. I've already posted a video that has a review of this, but yeah, this is where I went to next, was with Pet Shop Boys and Fairy. And, you know, this was when I was putting the headphones on so that I could play this loud and not worry about my neighbors. And this is, God, again, this is, to me, just about, as I said in my other video, you know, perfect album all the way through from start to finish. So many great songs on here. And this was the right one to go to. But then again, you know, it's this journey, what is it going to send me to next? And so the next one that came to mind, which was the appropriate one to play, again, is this one here, Scissor Sisters to Da. Their second album that was originally released in 2006, CD only, I think, at the time. This is a 2019 reissue. And this has my favorite Scissor Sisters songs on here, which are the last two on side four. It's a two album set. Might Tell You Tonight and Everybody Wants the Same Thing. But this really, really good album. But yeah, you know, that's where I was going next. And there's this, like, this buildup at the end of Everybody Wants the Same Thing. So it's sort of driving me in terms of, all right, what's the next record? I need something that's going to provide even more, you know, intensity with it. And so the one I grabbed was this, the eponymous album by The Tubes from 1975. And normally I play side two the most, because side two is just an incredible album side, one of the best album sides out there, in my opinion. But I warmed myself up by listening to side one, which, even though I don't listen to it all that often, it is a really, really good side. You know, with the, you know, it's got the songs Up from the Deep and Halos, and then Space Baby, and Malagueña Salerosa. So yeah, got me warmed up for side two, which, bang, comes out with Mondo Bondage. I've been tied up for so long. And then you've got What Do You Want from Life? I'm sure you're probably familiar with these songs. I don't need to say, you know, a lot about them, but, you know, what a great song. Then Boy Crazy, another just absolutely incredible song. And then, of course, there's, you know, the epitome of the album, White Punks on Dope. You know, Mom and Dad Live in Hollywood. Hang Myself If I Get Enough Rope. What an amazing album. So, wow, at the end of this, I'm like amped, and I'm ready for something else that's really going to continue this this feeling, this energy. And so where did I go? I went to the Stooges next, Funhouse. So 1970, the original is 1970, but this is a 2017 reissue. And again, so glad that I'm listening with my headphones, so I'm not bothering my neighbors. But, you know, down on the street, Loose, TVI. Oh my God, TVI. Such a great song. You know, and then you've got Dirt following that. Then on side two, you've got 1970, and then, of course, Funhouse, and then LA Blues. This is a very cool reissue on the very nice smoky kind of splatter vinyl. But yeah, I'm like, okay. After listening to this, I'm sitting there thinking, I got to bring myself down, okay? Because it's late. And I'm thinking, how am I going to bring myself down? I just don't, you know, I mean, I don't want to have something that's just going to like, boom, you know. So I thought something that could bring me down gradually, but still have some real intensity to it. And, you know, I don't listen to these records all that often. I mean, I don't, but I'm glad they're in my collection for when I do listen to them. And that's Led Zeppelin. And I listened to Led Zeppelin 4. So, which, you know, it was released in 1971. I don't have an OG, though. Mine's a 2014 remaster. So it's one of the Jimmy Page remasters. So I had to go adjust my treble and bass because, at least for me, I find the Jimmy Page remaster is a bit problematic there's like no bass and the treble is just, you know, just way too high and shrill. But anyway, yeah, it was a good one for, you know, me to play. And even though, you know, side two, which is what I was counting on winding me down, I mean, Misty Mountain Hop and Four Sticks and Going to California are such great songs to me. When the Levee Breaks, though, is really the epitome of the album. Side one, you know, is really good with Black Dog and Rock and Roll, and then the Battle of Evermore, which I really, really love. You know, Stairway to Heaven, it's a really good song. It's well put together, but you know, it's not the best song on here. Yeah, when I was 14 years old, it was like, oh yeah, what a great song, but it kind of became a caricature of itself, you know, over time. But the rest of the album is just absolutely incredible. And that was the way I kind of brought myself down. It worked because I woke up in my chair, and the album was over. And I'm like, wow, I didn't. You know, the Levee Breaks, I don't remember listening to it. I just fell asleep, I guess, you know, during it. But yeah, it worked. It brought me down and got me ready to get to sleep. So yeah, I haven't done one of these in a while, you know, for my weekend spins. But you know, sometimes you just don't know. You start listening to a record, and you know, your mind is, you know, open to perhaps, you know, whatever comes up. Or maybe you've got, you know, a series of records that you do, you know, you want to listen to. But sometimes you listen to that one album and it's like, it sets you off on a journey. That's what happened with me last night. I hope you enjoyed that. You know, please hit the like button. It does help. And if you want to subscribe, you certainly can. Don't forget, you can find me on Instagram as NewsDude76. That's NewsDude76. I also have a Facebook page called Kelvin Wazoo that talks about other, you know, I post my music videos or my YouTube videos there, but I also post other videos that I find and other music related content. So check me out there. And, yeah, I hope you enjoyed that. Don't forget the thumbs up, but always remember to pray for the people inside your head, for they won't be there when you're dead.